Welcome to the first webinar organized by the Wealth Management Club of the LPA. If you are having a lunch break, enjoy and stay tuned with us because our panelists of today have prepared you a very interesting package. Just wanted to thank also Gorka and Mathieu, who are then the two co-chairs of our Wealth Management Club. This club is dedicated to wealth managers, as you could understand, but also private bankers, multi-family offices, and practitioners who are interested to demystify the private equity asset class, also to a broader public, including private investors, as we will discuss today. So first of all, I wanted to thank you for your presence and also highlight that you can ask your different questions via the chat function and the Q&A button. So I will pass over now to Gorka and Mathieu, who will then introduce you then to the panelists of the day.
Hello, good afternoon, everybody. Just Mathieu, I think your screen is on, is not activated. Thank you very much for joining. This is the first webinar of the Wealth Management Club in order to demystify the asset class, private equity as an asset class. Today, I'm the pleasure to introduce to you Geert van Druyen, who is a senior private banker in CBP Kilvest, and also Frank Renert, who is a senior private banker in Crédit Agricole Indosuez, who joined this interactive panel to answer three questions. The first one would be why? The second one is who in terms of client target? And last but not least, what's next? What is coming in the coming 5-10 years? So before jumping into the discussion, I would like to share with you just a couple of figures in terms of, let me share the screen and let me just wait 1 minute. Mathieu, could you join us?
Sure, I'm around.
Okay, your screen is black.
Oh, sorry about that. I feel that everything is working on my side.
That's better.
That's better now?
Yep.
Perfect, thanks everyone. And thanks Gorka for this introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you today and to launch this Wealth Management Club together with you, Gorka, and to our two amazing panelists today. Just wanted to say a word on the private markets and where do we stand now, as it starts to be a very exciting asset class, especially for high net worth individuals. Remember that private equity is quite young. That started only a couple of years ago, let's say back in the 80s in the US, coming up to Europe in the 90s, in Asia a bit later on. So actually a very recent class, having experienced a significant growth over the past few years. Over the last 10 years, basically the private equity asset class has grown by around 10% per annum and is expected to follow a significant growing trend, expected to be around 15 to 16% per annum over the next 5 years. This asset class has been historically funded by what we call institutional investors, banks, insurance companies, pension funds, and as it starts to maturate, plus we are experiencing different regulatory environment, notably for banks, insurance companies with Basel II, Solvency II. We have seen the emergence of high net worth individuals, private investors, private clients, showing a significant interest for this asset class. Both in terms of diversifying their own portfolios, but plus looking for attractive returns. And what we have seen is that in turbulence period areas, such as what we are facing now with this COVID crisis, private equity has provided quite attractive returns to investors. So moving to the next chart, down to the page, it's interesting to see that fund managers have quite a bit expanding their offering to retail investors and not only to family offices, high net worth individuals. What we have seen is that there are increasing numbers of fund managers looking to attract retail investors, why we are still also seeing that a significant percentage, close to 45%, still not planned to offer that to retail. So we see that it's remained a debate, and this is, will be interesting to discuss about that.
Thank you, Mathieu. Let me share with you right now just four concrete initiatives that demonstrate there is a democratization or retailization of the private equity. Let's start by Moonfur. Moonfur is a digital platform. It's a kind of private equity supermarket, online supermarket, where you can invest from 100,000 euros in top quartile funds. Standard solution, but easy access to private investors. The second one is has been launched by BPI, Banque Publique d'Investissement France, which is a kind of the French sovereign fund. And it's a way of providing an access to retail investors in France from a minimum ticket of 5,000 euros, and then you have access to a portfolio of 1,500 French SMEs. The two other points I would like to share and outline today is two, let's say, regulatory reflections. The first one is the ELTIF, the European Long-Term Investment Vehicle, launched at the end of 2015. And this is a way of providing an access to retail investors from a minimum ticket of 10,000 euros. It's a way of that the Commission implemented also to capture the savings and to finance the real economy in Europe. Last but not least, even in the United States, the regulator, the SIC, is looking, is thinking of how to provide a direct access to private equity to retail investors. Is already the case through pension funds. Retail investors already, let's say, have an exposure to private equity, but this is indirect exposure. And now they are looking how we can provide this direct access to retail investors. So there is a trend. There is a clear trend to democratize private equity. Now I will stop sharing the screen and we'll come to our discussion. The first question I would like to raise and ask to our guest is the reason. The reason for offering private equity solutions to private clients. So I will start with you, Geert, if you don't mind. From a wealth manager perspective, what are the main reasons for you to offer a private equity solution to your clients? You are on mute, Geert.
I think when you look with your clients, is it okay now? I think when you look with your clients and you are deciding about their asset allocation, it is logic that private equity has a part in it. But I think the first conviction has to come from the wealth manager himself, who sees it as a real asset class in the diversification of the portfolio of the client. And I think that's the beginning of putting private equity within portfolios of clients.
Thank you, Gert. Maybe Frank, you want to jump and add something else to this point about what's the reason to offer private equity to your clients?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. From my point of view, I think, as Gert said, there are a number of reasons, obviously. For me, two are clearly part of it. So one is the diversification element. I think that all of us know who work in the industry, and particularly this year, lately, we have seen that diversification is such an important element. So it's the basis, it has always been, and it, I think, will forever be an important measure. So it helps quite a bit to diversify an investor's portfolio, not only because it's less correlated to the traditional asset classes than other assets might be. And I would also mention performance. A lot of clients that I meet obviously are interested in the performance risk ratio and risk performance return of the asset class of private equity. That is quite outstanding to a large extent. So that is for sure another reason. It should not be the only reason. We will talk about that later, I guess. should not be the only reason to look at private equity, but obviously the return is an important factor.
Thank you very much, Frank. Maybe next question, Mathieu, for you.
Sure. Maybe we can add a quick thought about that, but maybe we can add the fact that we are dealing with real economy also, and maybe I liked it, the fact that quite a lot of clients are former entrepreneurs. It rings the bell to them to be invested in the real economy. So maybe something also to keep in mind. One question I have for you is what are for you the main pole of attention which are quite important to bring to clients? And maybe, Frank, if you have some thought about that, it would be great to hear from you.
Okay. I think about one or two factors that regularly come up in discussion that I think we absolutely need to highlight, especially to clients that have no experience in private equity up to now, I would always start with the fact that it is an illiquid asset class, for sure. So in comparison to other asset, more traditional asset sectors or classes that we know. So it needs to be clear that the illiquidity is a strong characteristic of private equity up to today. To a large extent, obviously, this illiquidity is also explaining, at least in my eyes, the premium, so the performance that the asset is paying. So it's not so much, I think, a question of exaggerated or particular risk, but it's largely a factor of performance. So illiquidity is also rewarding to that extent via an above average performance ratio. And the second one I would maybe mention is the particular element of distinguishing between the commitment that you provide initially when you look at subscribing to private equity and the actual amount that you invest over time. So I think that's quite particular. People have to, prospects have to learn about that to understand, because as time goes by, it will be a very important factor to understand well how you can manage your engagement in private equity over time once you have started to do so. So distinguishing between what you would like to commit, so at the end invest, and how quickly your money is actually invested.
It's a very important point, as capital calls are made progressively, plus distributions also are coming down the road. And if we put in perspective the fact that private equity funds are increasingly using a bit of leverage within the funds, it's something which changed a bit the cash flow profile. So really managing the cash flow, understanding the dynamics between capital calls, distribution, and the difference between commitments is very important. Thanks, Frank, for reading that. Geert, any views from you on the point of attention to clients?
Well, I think the points that Frank mentioned are the most important. And I think we could resume it as the difference of the asset class to other liquid asset classes. The life of a private equity is a lot different than the life of a normal stock you buy on a stock exchange, and that's why I agree with Frank. You have to explain very well the difference between the commitment and the exposed capital, the illiquidity of the asset class, the J curve, and the long term performance you get out of the class, and the difference of measuring the performance. You don't really look the same way as you look at the stock market, where you see the year-to-day percentage every day on your screen. The calculation is a bit more difficult, and that those are the things that you have to accompany your client with. And for me, the main reason is the difference of the asset class to a normal classical asset class. So I agree completely with what Frank exposed as the most important points you have to be aware of.
Thank you very much, Gert. Just good to know, this is a 45 session, so we cannot, let's say, explain all the G-curve and private equity specificity. Nevertheless, just I would like from the audience, if you have a specific topic you want to tackle the next time, please use the chat, because this is the introduction session, but we'll be more than happy to spend time on technical aspect in coming session. So don't hesitate to use the chat. Next question. One of the purpose of this webinar and the Wealth Management Club is to demystify the private equity as an asset class. As Geert Frank mentioned, this is an asset class that works differently. It's not a one-shot investment, it's a commitment, and then you have to deploy this capital. But according to you guys, you are front office guys, you meet clients, investors, what are the main topics we need to bring clarity to demystify the asset class? What are the main key points we have to clarify with our investors in order to bring them to this new asset class? Maybe Geert, if you want to share your views with us.
Yes. Well, I think the most important thing that we have to demystify on private equity is the first remark you get from a client: it's very, very, very expensive, because they see management fees, they see carry trade, they see all types of expenses within the asset class. And I think you have to explain to your client, the most important thing you will need to have is the return at the end of the road. And that's the most important thing, the net return for the client. And because if you look to the stock markets, and when you buy an Amazon or a Facebook and you have a good return after a year, nobody is talking about the wages that Mark Zuckerberg and Jeff Bezos earns within those companies. And they do exactly the same thing as the managers in those private equity. They create value. And I think that's the thing you have to say. When you see some percentages that are being used, like management fees and carry interest, you have to allow the managers of those funds to be well remunerated for the creation of the value that they did during the time that you were invested in the fund. And you only have to look at the net value that you get out of the fund. And I think that's the most important topic for me to demystify with clients.
That's clear. I agree with you. Pricing is always the first objection that comes on the table. But you are right. We have to look at net returns. And just it's interesting to know that the value creation of private equity mainly comes from what we call operational improvement, which are real projects in the company by the managers. So there is a real action on these companies to create value. So thank you very much. Frank, on your side, what do you think are the main objections or points we have to bring clarity to convince our investors?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, indeed, I think demystification, I like a lot the subject, because I think there's a lot of work still to be done. And I'm even surprised with the figures that you showed initially when we started up this webinar, that more than half, if my memory is now correct, more than half of the fund managers that were asked are not doing it today, are not proposing private equity today to their investors, and may not plan to do so. So I think, and part of this, I think, has to do also with demystification issues. And in addition to what Gerrit said about prices, yes, indeed, it's very often a comment that you have to confront when you start up a discussion with a prospect. Something else that, or some other points that I meet quite frequently in discussions, I would actually turn it the other way around to explain to the client what private equity does not stand for. There are many reasons or characteristics, but what is it not? Because there is this misperception. A lot of times I get the comment about it is something very opaque. So we don't know what is in there. It's a big black or dark portfolio, and there is no information about it. So for me, clearly, this is not the case. Second, the perception, which joins a bit what Gerd said initially, it's an exclusive asset class for very ultra high net worth clients only. So it's a kind of reservation. It's a reserved, exclusively reserved asset class for very high net worth individuals. Also here, I would say, no, this is not the case. Obviously, we have a graduated approach in private equity. We know that you can have a very varied look at the different steps in constructing a private equity portfolio. And there are different levels, obviously, within the portfolio, also regarding the amounts that you need to invest to access the asset class. But clearly, it's not reserved to only. So that's the second one. And the third one, I think, is also about the fact that it is, it's not what sometimes I guess I get as a remark, it's not a guaranteed revenue neither. Also here, sometimes there is a misperception. I will explain a bit further. Talking to clients, when asking them, have you done private equity in the past? Or have you some experience? And sometimes we get the response, yes, I did. And sometimes then additionally, they say, but it was not very positive because, and then you dig, you say, well, what happened? And they say, yeah, I was investing in a project. I came across that many times it was actually renewable energy projects. An example that I met a lot of times, be it solar panels, be it wind turbines, etc., in the past, and the client got a guaranteed revenue as promised. And clearly, again, this is not what private equity, that the professional industry is standing for, is about. It's not about a characteristic that says you have a guaranteed revenue neither. So these are three points that I would actually quite highlight. And would say that's not the private equity we talk about today.
Yeah, you underline a really interesting point, which is transparency. If we come back to the basic, what is private equity? Is to invest in an equity in non-listed companies. And yes, from a reporting point of view, we could get this transparency because you have a direct the information regarding the underlying companies. A private equity fund is around 20-25 underlying companies. If you compare to a listed equity fund, which is 100-150-200 positions. So in this way, it's much more transparent that I will say use it equity funds. We can talk a lot about transparency, and this could be another interesting topic for the next webinar, because there is a transparency around the valuation of the private equity, and this is another story, let's say. But yes, transparency is, I think, is a must-have. And I would say, in terms of objection, because you talk a lot about objection with clients, but maybe because we are offering guys, Mathieu and myself, I would mention a lot of objection, or let's say demystifying the asset class internally in our organization. Demystifying the asset class with control functions, demystifying the asset class with the main, with the stakeholders of the company. Because some of the time there is a lot of objection coming from inside the organization. So this is a little bit also the point of view I would like to share today with you. I don't know, Mathieu, you have this feeling on your side, but... Nice.
It's a key point, basically. It's a key point as private equity is sometimes seen as a black box, and we talk about that in terms of information and so on, and as well as how does it work really. Basically, it's probably one of the most simple asset class. It intends to invest into private companies. There is a mechanism of commitments, capital call distribution, and so on. But it's very important for everyone to be aware about that and fully share your point. One of the key points of demystifying this asset class is not only on the client side, but also with all third parties, let's say stakeholders within the investment process within the bank.
Indeed,
right.
Yeah, if you like, I can add maybe one or two comments to what you said, because indeed two very important points. First, the reporting side, as you mentioned it. Personally, I believe this is something that even the industry and the private bankers talking about it are still underestimating to some extent. So it's very important not only to pass the message to the client, in my opinion, if I may say so, to propose or to introduce in order to avoid saying selling, but introducing the product or the instrument of private equity to a new audience. But that's, of course, an important step. But behind the reporting side, keep track of what is happening in the private equity the client has been investing into. Report about it, tell him, give explanations, what does it mean, etc. is, I think, very, very, very important. It's a very important element in order exactly to promote the private equity and to get to the next level and have more people investing in this asset class. And the second one that, Gorka, you mentioned is about the in-house organization. Indeed, we see also with us that it is important to have the wealth managers, if we talk about private banking now, sharing and accepting the asset class, because they are talking to the client. They have still today, I think, this holistic view, or ideally they have this holistic view about what the client's assets are about, may have this consolidated perception. And in that case, indeed, it makes a lot of sense that the private equity is part of their structuring idea for the present, but also for the future, because structuring the wealth means going forward and having a look at what is happening over the next years with that kind of clients. So it fits well, actually, with the perception of the wealth manager.
I think it's worth spending time on this topic. How do you share the information with your clients to make people understand this is not a one-shot investment. You commit for the coming 10 years, it's a commitment, and then we come back each quarter to share, you know, the new investment, the new exit in the portfolio. But it's interesting to check with you, how is your feeling? How do you share this information with your investor? How is the appetite of your investor to get this information? And I guess it depends on the level of expertise and maturity of each investor. But generally speaking, how do you share this reporting with your investor, Frank or Geert?
Well, I could start on it. I think it's very important. You have to live the investment with your client. So if you get your three monthly reports from the fund, from the private equity fund, it takes a little bit of an investment from the wealth manager, firstly, to go through the documentation you get and to share it with your client, and not just forward it in an email. I think you have to discuss it with him, and you have to make him live the life of the private equity. And that is something that we, as wealth managers, haven't always done in the past, because as Frank mentioned in the first, before, in the time, it was an asset class only for the ultra high, because of the amounts that you had to invest in a private equity fund, and they mostly had people around them to do that work for the wealth manager. Now that it's getting a little bit more open to more clients through more accessible products and offerings of banks, I think as a wealth manager you have to put a little bit of more effort in it to share all those informations with your clients and make it and make it more a experience of the investment.
Yeah, I can only join what Gerrit now said. It's really, really important to follow up with the clients. Basically, we are now sharing with them the reporting that every fund or program is issuing on a regular basis. So this is systematically shared with clients. Some clients obviously even have a consolidated approach, and reviews are organized, including all the various programs they invest into. And some, I would say, in that case, somehow more advanced investors are also enjoying today a kind of projection where you put in perspective the current investments of the client, the reportings of the existing, and then the projection into what may be next. So which joins what we said initially when we spoke about the importance in knowing what is your committed amount and what is to come in terms of capital calls, what can the client expect, the J-curve aspects, put all of this into perspective and give him a projection of how the client needs to manage his wealth and the money that he's dedicating or potentially dedicating to private equity in the months and in the years to come. So all of this, I think, is part of this organizing way to understand well the process, to digest the information that is coming in, and to avoid that at one point the client says, I do not know what my money is invested into, and I have no clue what is happening next.
Thank you. I think it's crystal clear, this point of reporting. Maybe the time is running, so we jump into the next section, Mathieu.
Yeah, it would be great. One point, it's interesting, we have a good question on the Q&A side, is the link between access to information and the fact that private equity is targeting professional investors. We see these questions, interesting questions. And it's a question about what are the targeted clients. So let's move to the second part of this panel discussion. And the first question is, what is the typical, let's say, clients profile and targeted clients for private equity investments? Gert, it would be very interesting to have your views on that.
Yeah, well, if you ask me, I think every client should get it. But we live in a world where we also have regulators around us. And so we, MiFID has regulated our client base. And as we are working with retail clients, professional clients on demand and professional clients, we have to respect also the MiFID regulation in towards that. So I think it's very important as a wealth manager to go through your client on his MiFID profile, I would say, and see if he has experience or knowledge, or if he has the long-term view of an investment. You shouldn't invest it with clients who have a short-term view on their portfolio, who don't want any risk on their portfolio. So I think the basis to propose it to clients is firstly have a good discussion about the profile and their investment outlook on the long term in the framework of the MiFID regulation, so that the client really understands where the asset class is sitting within his whole portfolio environment. And I think we have to respect that. And it's sure, as it is a very long-term in investment, it is not a proposition you will make to elderly people. It's more an investment you will make to younger entrepreneurs who are getting out their portfolio and who diversify their risk through a bank portfolio. And I think there you have a lot of possible clients to invest who can understand through the MiFID regulations also what the private equity as an asset class means within the total picture of their portfolio. So I think the regulation, it can be a break on the investment side, but it can also be viewed positively when you put it on the right place, when you make the analyze with the client. But it's a real discussion you have to have with your client within the MIFID framework.
Thanks, Gerd. Very interesting. Frank, any additional points would like to make on the targeted clients?
Yeah, about the target client, obviously, as Gerd highlights, the regulators set a certain base for all of us. At least that's still the case today. So we have to take this as a first filter to some extent. Thereafter, I would believe that the second, if I may say, no-go client base for me would then be as a criteria, the liquidity factor. As we said before, the fact of illiquidity is a major characteristic of private equity today, for sure. Having a client or a client base that would say, for me, this is an absolutely necessary. I need by all means to have liquidity in all my asset classes. I mean, it is rare. It may happen. It happens indeed. But it is a relatively exceptional situation that I think most wealth managers do not meet so often, actually. But if it was the case, just to say, if it was the case, then it would be a no-go factor for that precise client for me. In addition to that fact, I jump quickly maybe to one point that Gerd mentioned before. Maybe the age of the client, we agree that a lot of clients are out of the entrepreneur segment. Indeed, I can confirm it's also the case with us. The age for me is a relative to that extent. It's yes, at first sight, obviously, I'm not going to suggest private equity to the 80-year-old lady or gentleman. Even if it was an entrepreneur, it's a logical way basically to go ahead if you know that most private equity programs may have a 10-year lifetime or a bit more, a bit less. On the other hand, we have seen that for some clients, and indeed clients that have then to a certain extent already somehow advanced on the subject of private equity, that have been constructing a certain portfolio structure, the age is not necessarily an issue or problem. On the contrary, actually, for some who have more a kind of family perception, so where the family has a governance and the family is coordinating, at least to a certain extent, the asset allocation, for those, the private equity actually is part of the, if I may say, transgenerational thinking. So it is not an issue or problem to invest into private equity, knowing that the next generation will continue to manage the family assets, at least to a certain extent. So it can actually be quite an interesting subject also for, let's say, the elderly generation, but clearly case by case basis, yes.
I agree on that with you, Frank. You have to see it when you have older people, you have to see it in the bigger picture. If you have the follow up with the next generation or not. If you have the follow up, you can easily bring it in. If you don't have the follow up with the next generation, it's more complicated.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
I fully agree.
Guys, at this point, I may add something that you mentioned a lot of regulation, professional investors, retail investors. Well, from a wealth management perspective, we are creating value as private banker, filling the gap between the offering, the GPs, the private equity managers, and private investors, our clients, and not only structuring feeders or access to the asset class, but also through education and the time we spend with our clients mentioning all the topics you mentioned, and also follow through the monitoring and the follow-up. So it's really what we are discussing today. We are filling the gap between the offering and the demand a little bit. My next question, maybe for you, Geert, is before sharing a private equity, let's say, opportunity, is there any prerequisite, I mean, beyond regulation, I'm not mentioning regulation, but something that you keep in mind, a key criteria you apply before sharing a private equity opportunity with one of your clients' prospects?
Yeah, well, a prime criteria is that a client has to understand what he is investing in. That's a prime criteria without the regulations. You cannot sell that class of active to somebody who doesn't understand it and who is 100% depending on discretionary management, for example, when you have a straightforward portfolio. I think the understanding is very important because it's so different from all the other active classes. So it's very important to well discuss that with your investor and with your clients.
Okay, thank you, Gert. You, Frank, you mentioned the next generation also, but do you have in mind another criteria before sharing a private equity opportunity?
Yeah, I would actually link what Gert just said. Very, very important that the client understands the subject matter. I think it's not necessarily understanding to the last technical detail that may be sometimes a bit too much, but I think you may have other asset classes where clients are investing into and they are not necessarily knowing each little technical detail about a bond issue neither. That may be first sight a less complicated instrument, but only at first sight. But so I would put it maybe this way. Gerrit also mentioned conviction at the very start of our discussion. It's very important, I think, that you as the wealth manager, you as the professional private equity guy or whoever is sitting next to the client is convinced about what he is doing, he or she is doing. That's very important. But then I would say, but it's not about convincing the client. That's for me actually exactly what it should not be. So you need to be convinced, but the client needs to understand the subject and it must not end in a product push. So private equity should be everything but a product push, basically, to me. Yes. That's I think, very important. That understanding between the professional and the prospect or the client should be clear from the start.
So I guess this is a message for us, Mathieu. Huh?
Exactly.
So I leave the floor to you for the next one.
Yeah, maybe we can discuss a bit about the, and we have a good question within the chat actually, about how smaller wealth management / family offices can get access to this specific asset class. So the next question is maybe about the role of the wealth management industry regarding the offering of private equity products or services. How do you see that, Frank? What are the most important factors with respect to the offering?
I think we briefly mentioned it before. We said, indeed, the wealth management segment has an important role to play. If I may describe a certain trend that we see right now in the industry in general, and private equity fits into that in terms of communicating, educating the client base that is not yet aware or has not been investing into private equity yet. The advisory part, I think, so within the wealth manager, be it a wealth manager or a specific investment advisor working with the wealth manager, whatever concept that the professional may choose for is an important one, because in bringing the subject of private equity closer to the investor community and the prospects, the advisory part is a very strong one, obviously. As we said, I think it's all about explaining well the subject. That's a little bit one of the red herrings of our today's discussion. It's so important that the message gets understood. It's important that you understand some technical features that you may not meet with other asset classes, etc. So that advisory side, overall advisory part, is an important one. And then as the client, that's what we see, is getting comfortable with the subject, the delegation part is kicking in or maybe kicking in step by step. So I see it a little bit like a gradual line. You have a lot of advisory work. There are first investments, and step by step, the clients start to have their own inputs to feel comfortable. And they may actually go for some thematics, et cetera, to choose for which they are most interested in. And the whole subject gets a bit more delegation, actually. I wouldn't say discretionary as a whole, but more delegatory as such. So, and within that concept, obviously, I think the wealth management has a big role to play.
Yeah. Fully share the point, and notably highlighting the fact that wealth management is a quite long-term approach, having what you mentioned by the past or previously, is really the holistic approach about the client's wealth. Mm-hmm. And private equity is a long-term asset class, so both of them fits well together. Geert, any comments on your side about the role of the wealth management in terms of offering?
Well, wealth managements or private banks can help to make the products more accessible. And I think that's a big role that we have today, that it is no longer a product for the happy few or for the very ultra high clients. And that you make it accessible in a way for a lot more of your client base, with the diversification, with an offering, with the selection you make up front for clients, so you get sure that we will get the right type of private equity, because we are always talking about private equity, but private equity in itself is already a very large asset class with very different approaches and very different ways of creating value. And I think that's where private banks have a big role to play, that is to make it accessible and to make the selection for those clients in presenting them different types of private equity through a long-term lifetime. Because if you invest in private equity, it's not a one-shot investment, it's a conviction, and you will keep it on for the long term, and you will need to be fed with new investments over time.
Yeah.
There is a question from the audience, but you already raised this question, is how small wealth manager could set up private equity capacities? I mean, there is three pillars if you want to set up an offering: is selection, is structuring, is security access for your client, and is distribution, is what we mentioned about spend time with your client, explaining it, and at the same time following and monitoring. You could do externally, you can externalize, you could go, and this is the risk, you could go directly online through a standalone solution. But I think where we create value as an asset manager or wealth manager, is the holistic approach. For us, private equity is an additional component of your portfolio that brings diversification, you capture liquidity premium, but is another tool in our toolbox to manage your wealth in a long-term approach. So I think it's a key point, because it is a club for wealth manager looking for private equity exposure. So beyond the access to the asset class that you can get online or through a standalone solution, we are an asset allocator. We know your wealth, we know your personal situation, and when the magic happens and you put the great ingredients and you cook the personalized reset for your client. Mm-hmm. It's not about a standalone solution. It's not about just having access to private equity because it's trendy and everybody's speaking about private equity right now. It's because we believe this asset class really has interesting specificities to be included in your portfolio. I don't know, Mathieu, as a wealth manager, if you want to add something, but I think it's something key to underline, because this is private equity for wealth manager. This is the name of the club, of this new club.
And I would say I would add on that diversification is probably a key part. Diversification in terms of how what is the place of private equity within the overall client's portfolio, but within the private equity portion allocated, diversification is quite key. Sometimes we are facing questions or demands to go into this specific company or this startup. I would like to be part of the next Google or Skype or whatever. And we mentioned that the private equity brings returns on a quite resilient approach when you are enough diversified. And this is why diversification is key, whether it's about fund managers, strategies, and maybe would be a great topic points for a coming webinar. How to diversify your portfolio? What are the key things to keep in mind? And couple of items to mention. Fund managers have very different strategies. We can be talking about private equity, but also what is the place of private debt, private equity, real estate, and so on. Geographies. And it's important when you are building up a private equity portfolio to think about the diversification in terms of geographies. So I would say this is a quite important topic as we are thinking about a long-term allocation for clients, basically.
A lot of nice topics for next webinars. Just to finalize this first one, even if nobody has the crystal ball, I would like to ask to our two VIPs guest speakers today, the future. How will be the private equity in 5-10 years? But let's say, have you already identified any long-term for private equity, but in the wealth management context, have you already identified, a trend that's gonna affect or impact the wealth managers in terms of private equity in the coming years? Geert?
Yeah, well, you can see it on both sides. You can see it as the client's perspectives, or you can see it as the private equity industry's perspective. I think as a client perspective and as a wealth manager, I think we will see more and more private equity within the portfolios of clients in the next couple of years, because you see all those initiatives to make it more accessible through funds, platforms that are made up so clients can invest in largely diversified private equity portfolios. And so it's going to be accessible for smaller portfolios in the future. And I think we already see the movement in the last 10 years, and we will see that movement coming up to into the next 5 or 10 years. I think it will accelerate, because there is a real need, and it really has its position within a portfolio of the clients. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have the view of the private equity managers. And I think also you see in the private equity world and in the private equity managers, you see more communication, more transparency, more explanation of what they are doing. And this also will help the accessibility to the investment. And you even see some private equity managers already creating an offering that is accessible for smaller clients and no longer for the happy few. So for me, it's going to be an acceleration of what we are discussing now.
Thank you, Geert. Frank, from your side, have you already identified any new requests, expectation from your clients, let's say, or something that you expect in the coming years?
Well, I think Gerrit has mentioned most of the trends that I would share, basically. But and indeed, we have on one hand the clients, and we have on the other hand the industry. And I think there are absolute valuable trends ahead that can join each other actually in the future on both sides. For the clients, in addition to what Gerrit said, I think that the whole environment we are in, and we mentioned it initially because it's one of the reasons why also today we suggest private equity to investors, are ongoing and they will not change in my mind very quickly. And I think at least talking about the Eurozone, we are not going to see high yields soon. We are not going to see high interest rates or inflation soon. So these purely economical factors about the rationale why it may be interesting to go into private equity from a risk return perspective will be intact and will maybe even increase further. So I think that is just a very rational way to look at it. In addition to what Gerd said before, the democratization process of private equity, I think, will also continue. The whole environment about transparency of information, Gerd has mentioned it, the digitalization as a whole, the access to information, so this question about transparency or opaque, is also tempting to fade more and more. Also, this is supportive to that part of the industry. And then maybe a last comment. I think the demand for it will actually also increase because if we look at the M&A business perspective today, and if we look at just a few countries that we know very well that are our neighbors, like Germany, Italy, or France, we know that they have their medium-type enterprises, the segment of what the Germans call the Mittelstand, is so important today. And we know that a number of these businesses are looking for successors because there is a need for succession in many of these countries in this segment. And this, again, will increase the number of transactions or likely transactions. So overall, I think there are good reasons to believe that I'm very optimistic about private equity. There's a long way to go visibly on the investor side, but there are many reasons why I think the path is open.
Okay. I would like just to remind that Frank and Gert are private bankers, so they share their views, let's say, from a wealth management point of view. They are experienced guys who are used to work and with private clients. So for people who joined later on the webinar, we really have this testimony from the ground, let's say. Mathieu, maybe let me ask you the same question as a private equity expert. Have you already identified any sustainable trend for the coming 5-10 years? What will be changed?
It's a good point. I feel that we are moving into an investment solution approach from private equity experts, whether it's coming from the wealth management side, the private banking environment. Basically, it used to be a product approach, meaning structuring a feeder from time to time, pushing it, leveraging the strategy or the geography. But basically what we see is now, we talk about the holistic approach, but what is important going forward is the investment solution approach to diversify the portfolio. We didn't talk about primary versus secondary or co-investments, but it's a key point to keep in mind when we are building up a portfolio. I would say selectivity also is very important, and due diligence are quite key if you want to access the private equity asset class, because if you want to get this liquidity premium and get the outperformance compared to public markets, you have to be very selective and reach what we call the first quartile, meaning the best performers, the best fund performers. Otherwise, it doesn't really make sense to stay illiquid. So investment selection and portfolio construction is quite key to me, and I guess it would be a great topic to discuss during a next workshop, I would say early 2021.
Thank you very much, Mathieu. We are running out of the time. 2 minutes left, 1 minute. Maybe we can answer a couple of questions from the audience. Stefan?
Yes, so excellent panel. So the first questions we have received via the Q&A are, has there been an evolution over the past 2-3 years in the maturity of private clients when discussing private equity investments with them?
I guess this is something for our dear private bankers, because you are the guys who meet more clients And if not, there is an issue, I guess.
Yeah.
Will I start, Frank?
Yeah. Short comment. Yeah, if we talk about the last 2 to 3 years, it's very difficult to quantify, obviously. I couldn't give you a percentage or rate now, or ratio, but I can share my perception. My perception when talking to clients and just thinking about different individual meetings over that time, and on the topic of private equity, it is mentioned more often than before, yes. So there is an evolution. So it is more often also a request that may emanate from the client, whereas before maybe it was always systematically the wealth manager or the banker putting the subject as a question mark forward. We get more comments, we get more comments actually also from our audience. Recently, we have had quite a number of clients, though most of them were starting, either they had started to invest over the last 2 to 3 years, or they were in discussions with us to invest during that period. And they were putting forward more actively comments, especially this year. I mean, this year, Mathieu knows from some meetings we shared where we were confronted very proactively by the client. What was our opinion about, well, the impact of COVID on the industry? How should I position myself in that respect? So I would say yes, more proactivity and more interest overall from the client base over the recent past.
I agree with you, Frank. There is more interest, and there is more, and clients are more looking to private equity. I think there is also one reason for me personally. I think there is a more positive approach in the financial press towards private equity. If clients begin to understand that products that they see every day, or they have every day in their closet, are made by private equity companies. Today, the mention is more positive within the financial press, and so clients also hear more speaking about it in a positive way. With positive results, and I think that is also helping the global perception of the private equity between clients, between private bankers, between the banks, between the investors, and between the private equity managers themselves.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's for me a positive evolution that will go through in the next years, and which will help us, Frank, to convince our clients and to help our clients in their investments.
If I may add, because thanks to guys like you, I met also clients when we are introducing a new private equity solution. I think there is the learning curve has improved. Now I'm meeting more and more clients looking for allocating to private equity long-term, looking for kind of PE mandates, looking not just for one single fund, but just, okay, I would like to create a private equity allocation over the next 3-4 years. Could you help me? Mm-hmm. And it was less the case in the past. So that means, from my perspective, that the learning curve is increasing progressively. Mm-hmm.
Another question was also asked, since you also mentioned the SEC trying to open progressively the access to the private equity asset class to private investors. What about Europe? Where do we stand, and are there some obstacles right now?
Mathieu, can I take the question and then you can complete?
Go ahead.
The first reason, let's say, it's a really an easy one. It's Europe is not US. US is a single market, and Europe, it's the integration is Europe is not at the end of the day so good. We have something called IFMD, which is the main regulation to distribute alternative investment funds over Europe. And this IFMD has been let's say, implemented locally in different ways. So there is no full harmonization over Europe to distribute alternative investment, not only private equity. In Europe, we have the LTIF, which was end of 2015, a first step to provide access to private equity and other private markets asset class to retail investors. And now it's good to know the European Commission is making a new assessment to capture and to get the insight of the, let's say, financial players, because they are in mind to create or to renew IFMD regulation. So we are still progressing. We hope to be in a unified market one day, like in United States, step by step.
Yeah, and to add on that, I would be quite careful about the retail segment, to be honest, because the main point about the private equity asset class is the liquidity, and this is something we have to keep in mind to some extent, even if now we see increasing, let's say, semi-liquid options or you know, liquidity coming up into the private equity asset class, it remains, and it has to remain, an illiquid asset class, because it gives time to private equity fund managers to work closely with companies. So liquidity is a key point, and this is something which is very important. So education, finally, at the end of the day, really the education about how does it work is very important if you want to get access to private equity. So I would be, let's say, a bit careful about the retail segment. And one point is, of course, US is not, I mean, is not Europe. LTIF is an interesting approach, knowing the fact that LTIF is also focusing on direct investment. So it's a direct fund. It's not a fund of fund approach, or at least just on a diversification purpose. So it comes back to the how to build up a portfolio. And it's important to keep in mind that having or building up a portfolio of private equity investments is not only 1, 2, 5, 10 companies. It's more about being diversified across the whole asset class.
Great. Then let's tackle quickly the two last questions. The first one was about the upcoming fundraising of funds, and how do you keep informed? Are you selecting funds, or how do you know about that?
Mathieu or myself, as you want. For this well, one, you can start, and then we'll add something.
It's a small world, basically. Private equity is a small world. So once you are in, it's quite easy to know a bit everyone. It's still important to keep in mind that it still remains a bit an access market, meaning to get access to the best performers is not so easy, basically. Only a couple of investors are composed of any private equity funds. So you have to get access to private equity funds. But basically, it still remains an intermediated market with some M&A people, some fundraiser, which are there to make the link between GPs and LPs, meaning fund managers and private equity investors. So I would say it's a small world.
I will try to rationalize a little bit, but that's true. The private equity could be passion, but at the private bank side, we try to rationalize and then to compare benchmarking a little bit, even if we know past performance don't mean future performances. But we try to rationalize looking at, let's say, key criteria like the experience, the key people, if the people will still be there to make the good deals, how they manage risk, the risk management, the liquidity, the valuation, and so on. So it's not just a question of figures, but it's really when you make a due diligence is to look at the sensitive points. And regarding fundraising, today the private equity has professionalized a lot. You have data providers, different data providers who where you can find the information, who is raising money, who is not raising money. Of course, as you mentioned, Mathieu, you have your own network, and private equity is still a private world.
And then also the last question, Gert mentioned it in the beginning in his intro, so the fees, how does then the fee structure look like when you ask your private banker and because you're interested and you would like to invest into the private equity asset class? Without entering too many details, what could you share with us on that point?
I think on the you have to be very transparent transparent to all the different layers of fees that you can have within within a private equity. The more is it accessible, the more layers you have to go into the fund. So you will need a feeder fund, or you will need another type of vehicle to invest in. So every vehicle will have a little bit of fees that are taken into the portfolio. And so I think it's not the question of the number of fees or how high the fees are. It's a question of the transparency of the fees that are taken in the different investment vehicles to the real private equity fund, and how it is going to be represented within the portfolio of the client and what it's going to cost him for the analyze that the bank made. Because guys like Mathieu and Gorka, who make the selections for wealth managers to give it and do the due diligence to present it to our clients, the bank also has to earn money through those proposition. Like we earn money when you buy a stock, you pay depository fees, you pay transaction fees, so or management fees. So that is the same. It's the same evolution. You just have to be very transparent. And as I said in the beginning, at the end, you have to regard or look to the net value that will be created for the client. It's just a question of transparency.
Maybe the good news now for retail investors, the regulation MiFID II defined the key information document, and you have to disclose all the cost of the fund. So the regulation also bring a really positive aspect in terms of transparency. So now a retail investor who goes into a private equity fund knows really well the total cost of his or her investment.
Fantastic. Thanks a lot for all those insights, Gert and Frank, and certainly also Gorka and Mathieu. It's really a great session. Lots of concepts that we discussed, potentially many others that we will certainly treat next year, since you will create a wealth management webinar series. That's fantastic. And also just one of the found questions in the chat that we'll not treat today, but certainly during one of the next ones, was about the diversification, be it in order to insert private equity in your portfolio, the global one, or then within even a private equity funds on the GP's level. So thanks a lot again. That was wonderful. We also wanted to thank the audience. Thank you for your presence, certainly, and wanted to show you quickly the two last webinars we will organize with the association over the tomorrow and also next week. So first of all, one around Brexit with also Martin Bresson from Invest Europe can be very interesting also with lots of different ideas. And the last 10 years, 10 minutes of the year will then be with our chairman, Klaus Mansfeld of the LPA. And this session will afterwards be followed by a new series, which we will develop over 2021, which are the GPLP interview series. So stay tuned. Thanks a lot and see you soon. Stay safe.